Okay, we were looking at radio buttons last time, and I'm going to pull up the example that we had so that we can look at it. And then going forward, we'll look at a better solution. And by better, I mean it is, it will require less changes if stuff changes, if circumstances change. That's typically one of the main factors when if I talk about one way of doing something being better than another, is that if something changes, for example, the number of radio buttons changes, then how much work do I have to do? If I have to do almost no work, that's better than having to do some work. So let's take a look at where we left off last time, and then see how we can make it better. Guys want to hit the lights or whatever to make it easier to see, it's up to you. Figure out the best combination. All right, here is the example we were looking at, and that we have three radio buttons. And if we look at the code here, I use the same instruction I used for the other one, get element by ID. The difference being is that with the radio button, each individual option has its own ID. Whereas with the drop-down, the whole drop-down has an ID. So that's really the difference between the two. With a drop-down, I can say, here's this ID, what is its value? That's essentially what I'm saying here. Here is its ID. Here is this ID. What is its value? But with the radio button, each individual thing has its own ID. So what I have to do is I have to look in turn, look at the first one, see if it's checked. If it's checked, then we have a winner. That's the one that I want. Then I look at the second one, see if it's checked. If it's checked, then that one is the correct one. Finally, if the third one is checked, then the third option is valid. Now, radio buttons don't have an ID in common, so get element by ID only gives us one of the radio buttons. We need a way to refer to the group of radio buttons all at once. And that is done with get element by name, because they all do have the same name in common. All right. So to correct us to be more flexible, and what do I mean by more flexible? Well, right now we have, what, three choices. Could you imagine we could have 10 choices or more? And if we did that, then it would be awkward to have that block of repeating code 10 times. And it would make it hard to maintain. So what we're going to do is we're going to refer to the radio button group using the name. And instead of get element by ID, it's going to be get elements by name. Notice a subtle change. Get elements by name is plural, as opposed to get element by name, which is singular. What's the difference between it? Well, an ID uniquely identifies something on the page, so you know there ought to be only one. Whereas with radio buttons and other things with names, there could be more than one thing on the page that has that name. So therefore, we say get elements by name. So that's going to make the code a little bit different, because if I use get elements by name, I'm not pointing to just one thing. I'm pointing to possibly a list of things. Now, in computer programming, when we talk about a list of things, we're talking about an array. All right? So get elements by name is going to give me an array or a list. What's the difference between an array and a regular variable? An array can have multiple values, whereas a regular variable can only have one value. So what that means is we can look at the first element in the list, the second element in the list. We have to specify when we're looking at something which one, the first, the second, the third, the fourth. Now, in programming, typically the numbering starts with zero. So the first element in a list is element zero. The second element is element one. The third element is element two, and so on. So I'm going to write the code that will use get elements by name, all right, and loop through and look to see which one was checked. And then I'm going to write it, make sure it works, and then we'll go by, break it down, and analyze it. So right, let me make sure this works. I believe that's correct, but, you know, I could be having an off morning. It's too early to tell. Here, looks like it works. Alright, let's look at this and see what we're doing here. Alright, this code is the same as we had before. We initialize that variable to an empty string. In other words, before we start looking at these, we don't know what the background color is. But we know we're going to store it in a variable, so we set that variable equal to nothing. Here, I'm defining a variable called radio button group, and I'm using it to point to the radio button group. What's the radio button group? It's all the radio buttons that have the same name. So, my variable radio button group is pointing to the list of radio buttons that have the name TXTBG. Now, remember, there can be more than one thing that has that as a name, right? In fact, that's the whole idea of radio buttons, is that there's more than one thing that has that name. So therefore, radio button group does not point to a single radio button, it points to a list of radio buttons. All right? And in our case, that list of radio buttons contains 1, 2, 3 radio buttons. So radio button group points to a list of radio buttons, a list of individual radio buttons, all right, all of the radio buttons that have TXTBG as their name. So there's three of them. What are those three called? They're called radio button group sub 0, sub 1, and sub 2. The sub is short for the word subscript. It's the position of it in the list. And again, remember we start numbering them with 0. So, radio button group is a list of 3 radio buttons. Those 3 radio buttons are numbered radio button group 1. Oh, I'm sorry, radio button group 0, radio button group 1, and radio button group 2. So, at this point, this has a list of radio buttons, 3 of them numbered 0, 1, and 2. All right? That's called an array or a list. All right? Now, here's a loop, and we haven't seen a loop before in this class. What this says is for I equals 0, I is less than radio button group length, I plus plus. This is a loop, and this is a very common thing to loop through a list of items. This will loop through all of the radio buttons in my radio button group list. I equals 0 means the first one that we're going to look at is radio button list item 1. I'm sorry, the first item, which is item sub 0. Alright? So we're going to start our list looking at the list item that's numbered 0. In other words, the first item in the list. Okay? That's what I equals 0 means. We're starting at the beginning of the list. I less than radio button group dot length. What do you suppose radio button group dot length signifies?
Length of the array.
The length of the array. What's another way to say the length of the array? Yes.
The amount of items inside of it.
How many items are inside of it? So in our case, this is a value of 3. So this middle part of the for loop, notice there's 3 parts, they're all separated by semicolons. The middle part says how long we're going to repeat this block of statements. Alright? The for loop is a loop, which means that we're going to do a set of statements over and over again. This middle section says how long we're going to do this. And we're going to do this as long as the variable I is less than the length. Alright? Let's look at the last part, then we'll talk about how this all works together. Finally, I plus plus is the same thing as saying add 1 to I each time through the loop. That's just a shorthand syntax for saying add 1 to I each time through the loop. So what is this doing? This is going to start I off at 0. We're going to do it as long as I is less than the number of buttons in the group, or elements in the group, and each time through, we're going to add one to it. So given the fact that our radio button group has three elements in it, how many times are we going to execute this loop? Three. First time, I is equal to 0. Is 0 less than the radio button group length? Yes, it is. 0 is less than 3. So we go and we do these instructions. We'll talk about these instructions in a minute. I just want to make sure we understand how the loop works first. So we complete that loop. We add 1 to I. I now has a value of 1. Is 1 less than the radio button group length? Yes, 1 is less than 3. So we do this again. And look at the second element in the list. Third time through, we add 1 again. So I has a value of 2. Is I less than the radio button group length? It sure is. 2 is less than 3. So we do it one more time. This time looking at element that has a subscript of 2 in the list. Now we add 1 to I. I now has a value of 3. Is I less than radio button group length? No, it isn't. Radio button group length is 3, and I is 3. Therefore, we are done, and we don't execute the loop again. So the bottom line is these two instructions, or these three instructions, these three lines of code, get executed 3 times. Once with I having a value of 0, once having a value of 1, and once having a value of 2. I can show that. I'm going to put an alert in here. What is an alert? An alert is just a simple way to display a message up in a little pop-up window. I sometimes use these for debugging, but in this case it will be useful to show me the value of I each time through the loop. So if I save this, open this guy up, hit this, tells me I has a value of 0, I has a value of 1, I has a value of 2, and then we're done. Alright? So, this block of code gets executed 3 times. Now, let's add a radio button here. So we added the radio button to that list. Here's where the real benefit of this comes in. We should not have to change this code, because this code will now not execute 3 times, but it will execute 4 times. Why? Well, because radio button group length is now going to have a value of 4, not a value of 3. So I is going to be 0, 1, 2, and 3. We can see that. I has a value of 0, 1, 2, 3. All right. Any questions about how the loop works? Yes.
Just to be clear, in this case, can you only check one radio button, or does it just display the last one that was checked?
Well, radio buttons, by definition, you can only check one of. So in other words, this if statement is only going to be true one time at most throughout the loop. All right? You couldn't do this if these were checkboxes, for example, because checkboxes aren't mutually exclusive. So you could check a couple of different checkboxes. Good question. So, that's the structure of the loop. We're doing these statements one time for every item in the list of radio buttons. And the items are numbered starting with 0. So if there's 4 items, it's 0, 1, 2, and 3. Alright, so what are we doing here? We're asking if radio button sub I, notice these are the square brackets, is checked. And I'm saying checked equals true. I also, by the way, since checked is a Boolean, could simply say that. And it's the same thing. I could either say, is it true, or I could simply just say the variable, because it's already a Boolean. It's already been evaluated. So what does this mean? When you see this, you mean this shows which item in the list you're talking about. I'm talking about the item in the list that has a number of I. Well, that's going to be different each time through the loop, right? First time through the loop, I is going to have a value of 0. Second time, it's going to have a value of 1. Third time, it's going to have a value of 2. Fourth time, it's going to have a value of 3. So in turn, this will look through every item in the list, starting with item 0 and going through the last item in the list. And I'm asking, is it checked? All right? Is it checked? If it is checked, then that's the one whose value we want. Alright? So I ask for the value of that item. This code is very similar to the code we had before, except for two things. One thing is I put all this stuff in a variable, so I don't have to repeat that every time. I could have document get element by name text bg sub I dot checked, but that would get awkward to read. So I put all that stuff in a variable named radio button group. And wherever radio button group is used, this is what it actually means. The other thing is I'm using a subscript because, again, remember, because I used get elements by name in this case, I'm getting a list of items. So I can't simply test radio button group dot checked. I have to say which radio button do I want. And they're numbered starting with 0. And this is a syntax to refer to a list element. Use the square brackets, the subscript, to indicate which item you're looking at. So the first time in the loop, it's going to look at item element 0. The second time through the loop, it's going to look at element 1, and so on down the line. Questions about this? Now, remember last time we cheated. We cheated and we just said the validation was true. Alright? What I'm going to do now is I'm going to make the validation work. Alright? And we're going to take almost the same approach. I'm going to leave the second color as a drop-down, by the way, just in the interest of time. A good exercise might be to go and try to convert that into radio buttons and make sure you got the validation and everything working. I'm essentially going to do the same thing to get the value. I'm going to loop through all of them. Now, one of two things is going to happen when I make it through this loop. Either BG color is going to have a value or it's not. If it has a value, then they picked a radio button. If it does not have a value, then they did not pick a radio button. So I'm going to ask the question, if BG color equals an empty string, then I'm going to write an error message to that error field, I'm going to set the valid flag to false. The other thing I'm going to do is look to see if the two colors are the same. So if you understood the code before, this code is just about the same. The only difference is if we make it all the way through the loop and we do not have a value for BG color, then we know that the user did not select one of the radio buttons. And as was mentioned before, a radio button by definition can at most have one thing selected. And then I'm also looking to see if the selection for the background color matches the selection for the foreground color. And if it does, we also have a problem. So, oh, I didn't want to do that. All right. Let's say I pick something for the foreground color, but not for the background color. I click that. And I get the error message. If I pick the same thing for both, I get the different error message. Finally, if I pick different, then it works. Now, notice something. I forgot to clear out those error messages. So let's go back and do that. So now I don't pick anything, gives me those error messages. I pick something here, gives me that error message. I pick this, gives me that error message. Finally, I pick that, and it works without any error message. Except, I forgot to clear out the other error message. Error same. Questions about this? All right, so far we've been doing just real basic stuff with this, changing colors of things, but we can do a lot more processing as well, including mathematics and stuff like that. Alright, so let's think of another example. Let's say we have three employees, three employee types. All right. We have a manager who gets. How much should we pay the manager? $15 an hour. And no overtime. let's say we have a associate who gets paid $10 an hour, but gets paid overtime. Finally, we have a trainee who gets paid $8 an hour and gets paid overtime. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a page to go and do this calculation. All right. When I say they don't get overtime, that means that they just get paid the $15 an hour, no matter how many hours they work. If I say they work overtime, it means anything over 40, they get paid time and a half. All right. So, to calculate their gross pay, we're going to need to find out what job type they are, look at how many hours they've worked, multiply the two together, add in any overtime, and then that's the answer. All right? So that's going to be our task, and I don't know if we'll complete it today or if we'll complete it next week, but we'll start on this. So, I'm just going to just so I can save some typing, I'm going to just copy this one and I'll go in and edit it. That's not saving me a lot of time. I'm going to use I am going to, number one, do a sloppy job coding this. Actually, no, I'm not. I was gonna take some shortcuts, but that's not a good idea. Forms, again, are really just a list of items, so I put my form information in an unordered list. make sure that my HTML works first before I actually go in test this and start writing the JavaScript. I probably will not spend much time on the CSS, simply because that's not what the focus of this class is. Look to see what this page looks like. Alright, kind of the way I want it to. Do these work like a radio button? Yes, they do, because they all have the same name. I'm going to put in the hours here, put in the type of employee, and I'm going to click that and have the calculation occur. Alright, now again, can we complete this in time? I don't think so. Can we get something done in time? Yes. I want to be pretty sure that whatever I get done today and post up to Canvas works. Because it would be really bad if I left myself some errors to deal with on a Monday morning. Right? That wouldn't be too good. And it's that way if you're programming professionally as well. You know, you want to get Your ultimate goal, of course, is to get everything correct and to get the program working 100% properly, correctly, and so on. But you don't necessarily have to do that in one leap. You can do that in little pieces. And it's good for your attitude, and it's good programming practice to try to just get a small piece of the code working, call it a day. Then when you pick up, you can pick up with something new, all right, and you don't have some problems hanging out. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to fake the validation, and I'm not going to worry about overtime for now. All right? And in fact, well, we'll see how far we get. All right? We'll see how far we get. So, I know my recipe is going to look something like this. I'm going to call a validate function to see if it's correct. If that's true, if it is a valid form, I'm going to do the calculations. I'm not ready to write the validation right now. I don't have time to do that today. I could leave that for another day. So I'm going to fake it. How am I going to fake the validation? We have one line of code here. What's it going to be? I'll give you the first half, you give me the second half. It's going to return true. Thank you. For now, I'm just going to assume that I'm always filling it in right. Okay? Hey, I'm the developer. I can make sure that I check everything and enter everything properly. And I'm not going to try to trick myself in entering the name for the number of hours or something like that, just to, it didn't work. You know, I'm not going to do anything like that. I can behave myself and enter valid data in. So I'm going to just pretend, no matter what I enter in, that it's true, that it's valid. And I'll just make sure that I enter in valid data. All right? So, hey, we don't have to worry about this. And again, this is called a stub function. All right? It doesn't do what it's supposed to do, but it's kind of a placeholder. I can at least get the flow of this working. Then I'm going to do my calculate results. Now, I can build this up in little tiny baby steps, one step at a time. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to grab the value of hours, and I'm going to multiply it by the manager's wage rate, and I'm not going to pay any overtime. All right? So, how do I get the value of hours? It's in a form in a text box called with an ID of TXT hours and a name of TXT hours. How do I get the value for the hours?
Get document by ID, put the ID in there,
and then dot value. Close. Document.getElementById. TXT hours dot value. So what does this say? This says find a thing on the page, that's what document means, that has an ID of TXT hours and give me its value. So hours is going to have the number of hours in here. Gross pay equals hours times wage rate. Well, what's the wage rate? Well, it depends on the kind of employee I am. I hear the buzz outside. People are leaving class and entering the other class. Do I have time to figure that out today? We're going to say no. So I'm going to fake it. And I'm just going to say the rate, I'm just going to pay whatever, $15 an hour. I'm going to say the rate is 15. And I'm just going to assume that I'm only calculating managers right now. Now, finally, I'm going to put that answer in the place on the page called result. So, document, get element by ID, result, dot enter HTML equals gross pay. So in other words, I'm taking that gross pay that I just calculated, and I'm putting it in the inner HTML right smack dab here. All right? So I can go run this. Say, let's make it easy and say 20 hours should be $300. And there it is. Is it correct? Well, no, of course not. So I put in a trainee, it still says $300. So I'm not really doing the calculation, but I've gotten a start on the calculation. And now when I look at the time and say, oh, it's quitting time, time for us to go, I know what I have to do. I can even put comments in the code that say, implement what I have to do. Implement actual validation. Implement different rates. 15, 10, and 8. And then finally, implement OT for associates and trainees. All right. So by doing a little bit at a time, if I go and add two lines of code and all of a sudden this stops working, I'm pretty safe to say it's those two lines of code that messed it up, right? Because I got it working to this point. It's not complete, but I'm moving in the right direction. All right. Much better way to develop it than to try to write everything. If I tried to write everything and time rolled around where it was time for me to leave, I would be leaving where nothing would be working, and I will have gotten nothing. I will have made no tangible progress. I might have a bunch of errors in there, and I wouldn't know. Here at the very least, I know that this part of it works. So I know now what I need to do to get it to its final position, and that's what we'll do on Monday. All right, any questions? All right, we'll see you in lab. Have a good weekend.